It's now my great pleasure to introduce Professor Linda-Gail Bekker. She's director of the Desmond Tutu HIV Center at the Institute for Infectious Disease and Molecular Medicine, the University of Cape Town, and chief research officer of the Desmond Tutu Health Foundation. She's a physician scientist and infectious disease specialist. Her research focuses on programmatic and action around antiretroviral rollout and also integration with TB treatment, prevention of HIV in women and youth. And she has been previously the president of the International AIDS Society and co-chaired some of the international AIDS conferences. So she's going to provide a different and sort of perspective on the epidemic and how it's affecting populations and communities. And so thank you very much, Linda-Gail, for joining us today.
Thanks, Bob, and real pleasure to be here this afternoon. Thanks to you, Janine, Joanne, Val, for inviting me to give this. And it's a real honor to be on a panel with both Toby and Sharon, of course. So my job today is to take us through the concepts around cure and people, and really present the people face of this this aspect. And what I plan to do is, again, really bring home the need for a cure, to look at the ethical considerations for cure research, to introduce to you some interesting and exciting programs that are really seeking to engage fully with broad stakeholders, and then finally end bringing the whole thing full circle back to an excellent example, namely the fresh cohort. And so I'll be bringing a little more detail to that in a moment. So, of course, in the last 30 years, this virus has infected 78 million people and caused the sad loss of 39 million, mostly young people, breadwinners. And of course, we've had a number of eras we've had to live through, one of despair, one of hope, particularly around treatment. And most recently, of course, we've seen the proclamations that perhaps we are at the end of AIDS, that we've got this problem sorted. And in some ways, you know, we can move our focus onto other problems and epidemics. And largely at the heart of this has been the triumph of treatment. And here in the words of our past and much loved colleague, David Cooper, the story of HIV is a modern medical miracle. From despair and tragedy, we have moved into an era of chronic treatable illness in just 30 years. And Sharon already alluded to this. Treatment has become very manageable, from taking a handful of drugs that caused a plethora of side effects. We now know that a young person living with HIV, from having a life expectancy of only 39 years, can now expect a full life expectancy. And the Swiss cohort has demonstrated that you are more likely to die with your HIV than of your AIDS-related illness in this modern era. And we have been able to move treatment broadly. We've taken it to all parts of the world. And this has really been very important in terms of being able to demonstrate what we can do with treatment. Deaths are down globally, and this is very much due to the fact that we've been able to get treatment out to all kinds of people. And now, in fact, we have moved to believe that treatment brings an additional bonus, that by actually moving treatment out to scale, getting it to everyone, and doing it well, we can also impact primary prevention. So we refer to this as secondary prevention or treatment as prevention. And it was hoped, certainly at one point, that through this, we could stop the HIV epidemic. But the problem is not minor. And what has already been shown is that there are particular parts of the world, and in fact, here I live with Tumbi in Southern Africa, we face the biggest burden. We have the greatest number of people who live with HIV, and of course, many of the other problems and ills that go with living in a low and middle income region, very difficult to ensure that we can continue treatment, continue at scale, and continue it well. There are other regions of the world, though, that continue to grapple. And here, maybe not because of scale, but because of politics and because of discrimination and stigma and regulations and difficulties, these regions of the world, the Eastern Europe, Central Asia region, continues to see an increase in HIV infections and an increase in death over time. So the AIDS epidemic, I would say and contest, is far from over. Although we have now some very exciting tools, including therapy, in many communities, social, political, and economic obstacles get in the way, and so the epidemic is far from over. And Sharon mentioned, we are still seeing more than 1.5 million new infections every year, amounting to about 5,000 infections every day. We have a funding gap that becomes increasingly difficult to fill and to keep going. And so, to put it in a very simplistic cartoon, here we have 38 million people living with HIV. We continue to contribute about 1.6 million per year. There is no doubt that along with treatment, we have to bring primary prevention. We've got to somehow turn off that 1.6 million new infections. But what we're talking about this afternoon is, can cure contribute to helping us to be able to sustain our response to the HIV epidemic? And with that, I want to introduce you to a wonderful global cure ambassador, so you hear it from the horse's mouth.
This is Moses Supercharger from Uganda, a person who has been living with HIV since 1994. There are several reasons why we want an HIV cure. First and foremost, adherence of these medications is not easy. I've taken medication to close to 30 years, but I'm telling you, every day it's another story. My organs have been so good to me handling these medications with their toxicity, but will they be able to handle these medications for another 30 years? Therefore, I'm praying for an HIV cure every day. Accessibility of these medications, it's not easy, especially in Africa, because of different barriers. You can put medications in a clinic, but people don't access them because of infrastructure barriers. Stigma. As people living with HIV, we are being stigmatized every day because of our status. I lost a job on a radio station because of my status. Before, I was working very well. I was one of the most prominent DJs. But the time I came out openly to educate people about this disease, about this virus, and I gave my testimony, people were not welcoming me anymore, and I lost a job at the station. So stigma is one of the reasons why we want to see an HIV cure. Another reason is the cost of these medications. Can you imagine? 95% of the medications that we take in Uganda are bought by United States of America. And Americans also have domestic issues. What if one day America wakes up and says, okay, Uganda, we are not supporting you anymore. We have done enough. Take care of your business. Another reason is some folks in Africa have run out of treatment options. Some have failed first line, second line, and were put on third line. People are being denied visas to go to countries to do work. In Uganda, some embassies do HIV testing if you go for a visa. Why do they stigmatize it? Why do they do a test? Why do they want only people who are negative? Because they think that we are infectious. When we go to their countries, we shall infect their people. They think that we are useless, we are hopeless, we are going to die next week or next month. We might even die in their country and become a burden to them. That's why they stigmatize us and treat us that way. If there was a cure, they wouldn't have done that. Therefore, I am advocating for a cure of HIV. Before I end, I want to appeal to all people living with HIV. Don't lose hope. Researchers are spending sleepless nights, are working so hard to make sure that we get an HIV cure. In fact, the fact that researchers are caring about my life, that keeps me going. Knowing that somebody is caring about my life, that is really very important and keeps me going. I appeal to all the people who are funding research, who are managing research, cure research, to involve the community of people living with HIV, especially in Africa, where the biggest burden is. Involve the researchers of Africa. That will be very, very good. We want a cure of HIV. It will come. We've got to be optimistic. We've got to believe in our researchers. We've got to believe.
Amen to that. Thank you, Moses. And so that moves me on really to think about how the community sees cure. And this is a paper I want to alert you to. It comes from Australia. It looks at the view, and it's really worth reading. So Australian people living with HIV view cure as a relief from their sense of vigilance, relief from uncertainty about their health in the future, and because the alleviation of their social and psychological fears would not be achieved. So a cure in this view is only achieved when there is complete elimination of HIV from the body. So that, of course, raises a lot of issues around expectations about how people see cure. And it's important for us to really delve into understanding what language is used when defining and talking about an HIV cure. And of course, the strong need to differentiate between elimination of virus and remission, as it has become known. Moving us into another very important area, and that is the ethical issues related to HIV cure. And here's a paper, again, I want to alert you to. Jeremy Sugarman and his team looked at the very famous now Emmanuel benchmarks for research, using those concepts of social value, scientific validity, fair selection of participants, favorable benefit risk balance, informed consent, and respect for enrolled participants and community, and used each of those to think about how we think about cure research. And in the interest of time, I'm not going to be able to go into every single one of those. But again, a recent paper, well worth reading. If you're interested in this area, I really draw your attention to that work. Now, just introducing the concept of programs that begin to really unpack this, particularly in a global way. And the problem we basically face is there is no single industry, country, or agency that can develop an HIV cure that will generate significant impact. And despite progress at the global level, bi-directional processes to formally link community-level input to R&D actors and other similar communities are really weak. And I think COVID has again also brought that home. And public and private research efforts are often not shared until very late. The compounding factors are the disproportionate disease burden, limited available resources, and unique demographic challenges. And then identifying the sort of critical gaps are the delays in product introduction, acceptance, and uptake, missed opportunities to design a culturally appropriate HIV cure, and of course, not getting the word out to community about future innovation. In response to that perceived gap, a group who came together through the Towards a Cure initiative and the Sunny Lins experience in the US on the West Coast, and Sharon Lewin and Tumbi and others have been involved in this, we saw the development of this HCARP, or HIV Cure Africa Acceleration Partnership, which really has a wonderful history, starting all the way in 2013, and relatively rapidly moving through a number of steps, a number of meetings, and eventually a launch last year, with a broad consultation and consensus on the best attributes of the target product profile of a cure. And this has now been published, and their work continues. They are working through a theory of change that is demonstrated here for you, where a platform is developed to promote dialogue between key stakeholders to inform the target profile and help cure development processes, access, and rollout through coordinated stakeholder insight, driving collaboration between cure stakeholders while actively identifying new partners, and so doing, accelerating progress towards a cure. Here you see that that publication led by Sharon, published last year in the Lancet HIV, and really delving into, through a Delphi consensus-driven way, what the therapeutic modalities needed to be to guide the development of a cure product. And this was multi-stakeholder. Again, I won't go into it in details, but if you're interested, there is that publication and really well worth reading. The priorities for this program now is to ensure that the community's voice is heard, to convene people, to accelerate education, acceptance, and adoption, and to also bring in or expand the sort of stakeholder reach to support in particular under-engaged communities and to promote a human-centered design and delivery approach with actionable best practices. Not to forget, towards an HIV cure, and as Bob mentioned, Sharon is one of the co-chairs here with Steve Deeks, Francoise Barre, Suisi, the discoverer of HIV and a wonderful champion in this field, are really foremost in putting this initiative together. It is centered at the International AIDS Society, and it drives a concerted effort to accelerate global scientific research. More importantly, since 2018, it has held an annual Advocacy for Cure Academy in partnership with AVAC. It awards fellowships to talented HIV peer educators and advocates in low-resourced areas to really advocate for cure. And they have a wonderful grant program. Just to show some of these outputs, they've had two editions of the Academy, 55 fellows have gone through this, really extraordinary work to set up and build champions of the caliber that you heard in Moses' supercharger. So we really support this and hope that this will grow from strength to strength. In my last few minutes, I want to bring home a wonderful example of science and people working together beautifully. So, and I know the team are out there. Hello, Krista. I know that you're watching the seminar today. And I just want to really give a big shout out, not only to the cohort and the heroes who've been involved there, but also to thank Krista and her team for showing us a way of how we can do science in an extraordinary way. So here is their aim: to create a cohort of HIV negative young women at very high risk. This required a hyperendemic setting. And you've already heard from Tumbi that sadly the east coast of South Africa is really the epicenter of the HIV epidemic. We know that these young women not only face huge challenges that come from HIV, but also other structural and societal difficulties that put them at incredible vulnerability to HIV. So the FRESH cohort, standing for Females Rising Through Education, Support and Health, recruiting young women, empowering them as, in addition to the basic science, making sure that they have an empowerment program that works in a bi-directional way. So here you see this wonderful clinic beautifully set up in the middle of a shopping center with the hope to detect acute HIV infection, as Tumbi already so beautifully described. A number of these infections coming through, but at the same time, making sure that people are able to immediately get treatment at the time that they are diagnosed. And this is also important to say that the standard of care is the highest standard of care. So what I'm hoping to bring home to all of you today is that we can combine science and social good in the most innovative and inspiring way. And so let's listen to this group just for a few minutes.
I'll rise unafraid, I'll rise up, and I'll do in the Umlazi Township near Durban, the Reagan Institute launched the Fresh Study, enrolling young women at high risk of HIV infection. Because young women in South Africa are disproportionately infected with HIV, it's paramount to include them in research, including efforts to develop novel treatment and prevention options.
We need to strengthen it and really support it, because it will give us answers and also show us direction how to go in terms of intervention.
We are very excited to introduce treatment, early treatment, to our participants because it provides benefit to them, but also because we are addressing a very important scientific question regarding the science of HIV cure. But our goal is actually to prevent new HIV infections. So we are very, very careful to do the best that we can to prevent people from getting infected with HIV in the first place.
I see myself in them a lot. I'm also a fresh graduate. They're like my little sisters. It's very important for me to push hard so we can protect them from getting HIV.
They have been taught that you can rise up above what you see here at home. You can rise up above any circumstances and you are able to light up regardless of what is happening around you, you're able to rise above it.
So if we have programs like FRESH focusing on HIV negative young people who are at high risk of getting infected, I think we'll really be winning.
Visiting FRESH was amazing. It motivates me to work harder in the lab and to make progress faster in the lab.
A lot of science is people actually putting hope in scientists in order to make the next advance and in order to make the next discovery that will change the epidemic.
FRESH cohort is also working hard on prevention and looking at other research. So what is the best PrEP people would want, these young women would want, for instance? But of course, cure is very much at the heart of the work they're doing. So really looking at doing this, but bringing the community along in terms of education with community advisory boards, and making sure that the community has a voice, allowing participants to inform the design and the implementation of future HIV cure research. Very importantly here, you see again a full circle. Here's Moses Supercharger speaking to these young people, inspiring and making sure they become self-supporting. So basic science and social good, empowerment, life skills, career exploration, job readiness, poverty alleviation. And I know a large number of these graduates have gone on to college, to work, and to futures that are bright. So in conclusion, Bob and the panel, in my opinion, the best science is relevant science. Relevance asks, what is the priority? Science then asks the right question. If asked and listened to, community frames the context, and together, community and science can find the right answer. Thank you very much indeed, and I acknowledge the communities that work with us here in Cape Town. I acknowledge Krista and all of her supporters, and thank the people such as Moses, Dom Kemp and Mark Dybel, and others who helped me put this talk together. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Linda-Gail, for this really elegant and inspiring talk. So we have a number of questions. Let me just start with one related to antiretroviral therapy. I love your description of antiretroviral therapy as really a modern medical miracle, which I think it really is, and it doesn't quite get enough attention as to just how remarkable it is. But you also point out that, you know, the epidemic is far from over, despite the, you know, effectiveness of the treatment. One of the things that we see here at Hopkins is sort of inner city Baltimore, are a lot of people living with HIV who go on therapy, do well for a year or two with undetectable viral load, and then all of a sudden, they're off treatment with a very high viral load due to a whole variety of complicated issues that often are sort of not medical. But this is something that I've become aware of pretty recently and been a little bit discouraged by, just in terms of the difficulty of keeping people on treatment. And I wonder if you could comment on that.
Sure. You know, Bob, I think daily treatment, those of us who've, you know, had to take antihypertensives or, you know, even vitamin D at this time of COVID, you know, it's a difficult thing to do. And I can say I'm actually a two-time tuberculosis person. And, you know, I needed to have daily observed therapy. I was quite open about this. I went to the supervisor of the hospital and said, you're going to have to put this pill on my tongue every single day for me to finish the 168 doses I need to take. I'm a terrible pill taker. So aside the human behavior aspect of it, which is really difficult, I think you highlight the fact that our lives are complicated in this day and age. And, you know, downtown social at Baltimore, I know there are lots of social difficulties that people face, challenges people face. I had to unfortunately shorten Moses's talk, but he beautifully and eloquently said, you know, take a look at Central Africa, you know, or the Horn of Africa. We have a new war starting every now and then. We've just had insurrection. The reason I really wanted to bring the Fresh cohort home is that last week that clinic was completely trashed with political resurgence in the country. And, you know, and those things happen. And I love the first thing you asked Tumbi today was, are the women able to get their treatment? And, you know, and bless the team in Durban. They made sure those women could get their ARVs. But the point is, it's very difficult to keep treatment on the shelves and moving from the shelves to people's tummies on a daily, non-stop, non-interrupted way. There's a plethora of reasons why people and why we can't always meet people where they are. I think we're getting better at it. We're talking about differentiated service delivery now, and that's excellent. But even then, it is very difficult. There is no doubt prevention is better than cure, but cure is going to be better than lifelong therapy. And, yes. And you know, that's the way we need to go at this thing.
Yeah, I totally agree. A very interesting and difficult question from Mahidi Kadrui. An HIV cure will be one part of the solution, but what could we do to reduce stigma and ignorance around HIV that plagues populations worldwide?
Bob, you know, I gave a talk actually at Dave Cooper's, you know, when we celebrated his life in 2018, that I called AIDS is still political. And there's no doubt, you know, when we talk about types of diseases, HIV is right up there in terms of being stigmatized, politicized. You know, the folk who often have to live with HIV also often live on the edges of society in terms of what society thinks is acceptable. So they may be drug using communities or people who have sex with their own gender or whatever the case may be. And so what, you know, fuels this further is that we shun them. We make it very difficult for those individuals to seek their care, to find their way in the services. And as a result, we have less than optimal treatment. So there is no doubt that 40 years on, stigma remains one of our most difficult things to solve. And, you know, I know Tumbi and Sharon showed, you know, the fantastic, you know, leaps and bounds we've made in terms of cure. We know what we've done for treatment. We really sadly have not made the kind of progress we should have made around stigma. And I'm pleased to say now the International AIDS Society really is grappling with this. I think we all need to grapple with this at every level. More needs to be done. I'm afraid I don't have a silver bullet for you, and that's a gap.
Yeah, well, I totally agree. And I think that the COVID epidemic has really, you know, brought up the the real serious problem of ignorance of science and with just what a devastating effect that can be. I know you've done very important work on COVID also, and there's a couple of questions related to sort of the difficulty of developing an HIV vaccine, compared to the relative speed with which the COVID vaccines have been developed. Would you be able to comment on that briefly?
Yeah, I think this is one of the good things we take away from COVID is, you know, we can actually do science a hell of a lot quicker than what we have been doing. I think we've been living under some kind of misperception that these things have to take forever, you know, 40 years. And I think it's been extraordinary to see how the regulators have come to the party. We've seen amazing partnerships between public, private, academia coming together in ways that we have frankly never, ever seen. I mean, I think TB, we saw the step up to HIV, but really COVID has taken us to a whole new level. And I am really hopeful that we will not, you know, should we get the COVID epidemic, and I'm really hopeful that with all these wonderful vaccines and other ways we will bring it under better control, that we won't forget all these lessons, because the sense of urgency we had for COVID, we really should have for HIV and TB and malaria. You know, these diseases need as much urgency and therefore require us to have the same kind of response. And so I hope that will stay with us, going forward.
Well, thank you so much, Linda-Gail.